This is the Pebble delayed match to sample task. Let's look at a couple trials. Here's what you're supposed to remember. You're given two, after a delay of several seconds, you're given two options and you have to choose which one was the one you saw. So we'll do a few trials of this to get some insight on what's going on in this task. So by default, there's a 3.5 second delay between the sample, which is this first stimuli, and the comparisons, which you're supposed to match to. By default, there's a grid that's 4x4, and about half, plus or minus one, of the cells are one color, and the rest are the other color. The two comparisons that you're making differ by only a single cell. So basically, one red cell turns yellow. So you can see this red cell is yellow. This yellow cell is red. So it sort of moves a red to a yellow or a yellow to a red. I'll talk about how we achieve that in a little bit. And it's a forced choice. It's a dual alternative, two alternative forced choice tasks. So if you're just randomly guessing, your accuracy should be about 50%. And if you're doing really well, it should be 100%. I've found that for someone who's alert and engaged in the task, you can get in the high 90s in accuracy for a 4x4 grid. You can be 100% correct almost all the time if you do a 3x3 grid. And as you make this larger, accuracy suffers. So I've, you know, gone up to size 7. We'll look at that in a little bit too. And your accuracy goes down. It's still, you know, above chance, but down to say 70%, 60 to 70%. And this is interesting because it's really not too different than a lot of visual working memory tasks like Luck and Vogel's task, except, you know, like Luck and Vogel task, you see a number of objects and then you see a, which is oftentimes squares, not necessarily in a grid like this, and then you see a comparison and you have to say yes or no. So here you see a comparison and have to judge which one it is. In many ways it's not very different, but, you know, what is the numerosity for this? Is this 16 things? Is it 8 things? Is it roughly 8 things? Or in this case, is it 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 things? And this might, understanding sort of this layout might help understand what's the important thing in errors and what causing errors or producing errors in this. So I'll do a couple more of these tasks. I'm just sort of randomly guessing because I can't really concentrate while I'm talking. But I'm probably getting a little more than half of them right. Now, you might expect like ones like this might be easier because it's sort of a single thing. This might be a little harder depending on the swap, what's being changed. And so by default, this is 30 trials. We have 30 trials in this. Let's try to go through them all so we can produce the data. And I think we're almost ready. I'm just going to end here. Okay, so this is available in the Pebble test battery under battery match to sample. So it's a match to sample task. Let's talk about the background and history of this. This was designed based on a task that was originally developed for the U.S. military in the 80s. And in fact, they attribute at least the term to B.F. Skinner. Here's a research report from the mid-80s describing the UTCPAB, or the United Tri-Services... Tri-Services Computerized Performance Assessment Battery. And it was, you know, the Army, Navy, and Air Force got together and said, "We're doing these computerized test batteries. Let's have a one that we all use." And so they came up with maybe 40 different tasks, all administered on a single computer. It sort of subsumed a number of other test batteries, including the Walter Reed test battery. And then, since then, it's been commercialized, and I think it's part of what's called the ANAM now, probably in a new implementation. So, what's really nice about the UTC PAB is that they provide a lot of detailed psychometric information and rationale and things like that. So this is where it was described. This is a 340-page report by Perez. Let's see if I can get back to page 290. You can search DTIC. DTIC is Defense Technical Interchange Center or something for where military reports are stored. There's a lot of different papers. If you search for UTC PAB, you'll see a couple dozen papers describing how it's built, different people have used it, and things like this. This is my favorite version because it really describes all the tasks, and probably four or five tasks in the Pebble test battery, including match to sample, pattern comparison, matrix rotation, mannequin task, time wall, I'm sure a few others, are based on the implementations in this. And so if we go by published in 1987 by Perez. So they describe this as a spatial memory pattern recognition task, and I try to implement it as close to this description as possible. So they attribute it originally to Skinner and talk about some of the visual skills this involves, and then in detailed description how it works. They also talk about past research, related research, and in fact, this task had never been used exactly in the past. So they point to several other related tasks by Ichikawa, Klein and Armitage, and Phillips about memorizing dot patterns and matrices, including things like the symmetry help, what is used to remember it. So this gives you some background in these types of tasks. They also have described the reliability and validity, and so this is nice that at least for the Kennedy version, Kennedy 85 measured the Klein and Armitage version, which is not this task, and found a reliability of 0.93. This is really high. I don't know if it'd be as high for this task, and it also depends on the population. If you're testing this on children of different ages, you'd expect the older children to do better, and so you'd see a high reliability. If you're testing it on a bunch of college students, maybe the reliability wouldn't be too good, in meaning test retest intercorrelations between people. But if you have a high reliability like this, then that indicates there are systematic individual differences, and you could use it to correlate with other tasks. And so that's what the validity measures. And for example, the Klein and Armitage task correlates with Wace performance, but not verbal. So it's related to the things on the Wace performance scale. So this could be a short proxy for some subsets of intelligence as well. sensitivity meaning they me means by sensitivity is it sensitive to the effect of drugs, and they don't have a lot of evidence for that. And they describe this in detail, how it's implemented, including trials, data, training and practice instructions. And for the instructions, I try to use instructions very similar to this. So if we go return to the task, there's a number of parameters you can set for this. Well, let's look at the instructions first. If you want to edit the instructions or labels, you can select this, hit Translate Task, and then this screen will pop up. And you can edit these things, either translating into your own language or changing the instructions however you want. All right, so now we can examine the different parameter settings. So if you select here and then hit edit, there's several things you can change. You can set the size, and so we just looked at one that was size 4. And 4, you can be pretty accurate, but 7 is difficult. I'll look at a couple of those. Maybe we'll just do 5 of those. By default, it automatically runs. You get 1 second, 1,000 milliseconds to see the stimulus. That's not actually how the Perez task is defined. So in that task, you can look at it as long as you want. If you set this to 0, you can look at it as long as you want. But so this is just a decision you have to make, whether you get feedback or not, the number of trials and the delay. The default is 3,500. This could you could look at sort of decay of memory over time or interference over time by changing this. We'll make it short so that we can get through this quickly and look at what happens when we change the size to 7. So we'll do participant 200 so we can look at it. And here's the instructions screen. And this, once you run it, is all controlled by the keyboard. There's no mouse activity at all. So here you can see this is pretty complicated. Especially with just a glimpse, it's hard to tell, but you often can, it's the one on the right I can tell because I happen to look at the lower left corner and saw the little plus sign. So I think, you think about what's going on here. This 7 by 7 grid is 49 bits of information. And that's, you'd expect to see performance to start to suffer for remembering visual patterns of 49 bits. But at the same time, if we like run this again, you can, when you glance at it, one way you can do some sort of chunking. So if you look on the left, there's this sort of hook on the left, and then four or five other yellow sort of pieces. And if with just a glance in 1 second, you can sort of encode that, and maybe by just glancing at it, you're able to distinguish that hook on the left from the one on the right. And so I think probably if you were to figure out what makes this easier or more difficult, it's the patterns in it, not just the randomness, but the actual patterns, how they fit together when they're adjacent patterns that you could that are compact or something like that. So clearly, if I did a half yellow, half red down the middle, this would be easy to encode and easy to detect a deviation from. And so there's something about complexity here that makes it easier or more difficult. However, I don't think anyone has ever studied anything like this, relating it to, what's thought about visual working memory in a Luck and Vogel sense with object files. So there's probably a dissertation or two just in this task waiting to be done. Now, there's a couple things about how I actually built these comparisons. You can see that roughly half, in every case, roughly half are yellow and half are red. Sometimes it's plus or minus one or two that are yellow or red, depending on the size. But in every case, the comparisons are made by taking a red and swapping with a yellow. So it only differs by two cells. And if you look closely, you can see where those two cells are. It's the one on the far upper left, and then sort of in the second to right column, the third from the bottom changes. So that one flipped there. The swapping I'm doing here is completely random, and we can look at how I implemented that in the code, because I'm not sure how I thought of this, but it was pretty clever, I thought, when I went back and looked at it. I don't know if I'd be able to generate this again, but this is the code to make these matrices. So first of all, I know the size of the matrix, but I don't deal with the matrix. I just deal with a sequence of numbers. And I put a bunch of ones and a bunch of zeros together based on how many I want. And then I make a copy of it, rotating it by one. So here we have a bunch of ones followed by a bunch of zeros. And here we have a bunch of, we rotate it by one. So a one, I think a one flips from the beginning and moves to the end. So now all the ones at the beginning are going to match almost all the ones at the end, but except it's going to be off by one. And where this transition between these two is going to be flipped by one. So you're going to have this transition where a a 1 maps to a 0 and a 0 maps to the 1, but everything else will be the same. Then I put them together and shuffle them together and pull them apart and make them into a matrix. So they're guaranteed to differ just by a single move of a 1 to a 0 and a 0 to a 1. And that's how I make the target in the foil. So let's see. I was wondering how performance changes as you increase the size of this matrix. So I tested myself a little bit and I looked at size 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. And so for a set of size 30, you can see that, or for 30 trials, as I move from 3 to 7, where the number of bits is actually going from 3, you know, the number of bits is going from 3 squared to 7 squared, or it's, you know, increasing log with the log of that. So 49 different binary digits versus 9 different binary digits. You know, for 3 and 4, I was very accurate. I started getting a little, making a few errors for 5, and it slowly goes down. And I don't know if this is what this reveals. I don't think this is the same pattern we see with the verbal working memory curves, but we'd also have to correct for guessing and things like that. So to think about how this changes over time, I didn't see, at least with me, a sharp drop off at about 4, but this is not the number of objects. So this is already sort of 4 different objects. So there is something that we're getting from being able to group and put these together, because you're not seeing serious drop off till maybe between 5 and 6, which is between 25 and 36 cells. That's a lot of information that we're encoding. So that's sort of interesting to look at. I believe that the people who are currently distributing a version of the UTC PAB, I don't think they've looked at this as it changes over size, but they do have more normative data on many of these tasks, maybe a version of this task as well. But for the most part, this task has not been explored in detail. Okay, so now if you collect data and you want to see what it looks like, we can examine. I've got a bunch of trials here. And it saved in a CSV file. Now, previous to version 2.0, these are a little messed up because these target foil descriptions were saved with commas, so you're going to have a bunch more columns. But after 2.0, I changed that, so there's a little pipe symbol. So if you want to look at these comparisons, you can recreate exactly what the pattern they saw was and do some analysis on those. So I don't specify actually the size in this data file, but you could get that from looking at the length of this and see how long it took. This was the auto study version. This is how long my responses were, 3, 2, 10 seconds. This is the order, which means was the foil on the left or the right. And you can see that, you know, when order is 0, right shift is correct. When order is 1, left shift is correct. And that's all the data that are stored for this. Probably you'd want to look at accuracy and response time as the main dependent measures. And I've got a few more versions of this we can look at. This was a relatively large set, and here I've made more errors. My response times are still between 1 and 5 seconds, but I did a couple where I could choose study time, and if you let people choose study time, it will record how long they study, and so you may be able to use that as almost an implicit personality measure of something like need for cognition. Someone who looks at it longer has a greater desire to learn it. And so probably that will affect accuracy. The people who don't care very much will zip by really quickly. And that could be an interesting thing to look at as well. All right, well, that's it for, I think, the description of the match to sample task in Pebble. You can download it at pebble.sourceforge.net. It's available for free as part of the Pebble test battery. And if you appreciate this, give a like to this video. Thank you.